morning to everyone. Shall we start? It was already too long from the morning. You must have got bored by now. First question, how many lectures already on practice and procedure? You need any more?
Yes.
I don't think you need more. Anyway, I have only come for emphasizing two, three things. Because practice and procedure is going to be a part of your life now here at Tilakmar. It's an important road for all of us. The identification is far more meaningful and easier when you say, I'm going to Tilakmar. See, there are two aspects, please keep in mind. A client must come to you first. So, your existence, your survival, your continuation, your success all depends upon what decision you take for him. Therefore, when we see that there are four question papers, we think practice and procedure are very boring. Leading cases are much more interesting. But as a lawyer for this practice, I think your excellence in this subject is far more important. So as I said, he or she should come to you. For that you have to wait some time for some while. I gaane wala. Aane wala jaye na. For that it is important you have taken the right decision. Here comes the seriousness of this subject. If you take a right decision for him, the chances for his getting his relief, they increase. If he is successful, it results into his continuation with you. If he is not successful and he realizes that you took a wrong decision, God bless you. Aane wala kya. But you are still not to lose hope, strive hard, improve yourself and wait for another aane wala. Now with this serious aspect, that when he comes, your expertise, your knowledge with the procedures makes you responsible to take the decision that which is the remedy which is most suitable for him. So it is extremely important that you equip yourself. Equip yourself with that ability that when you hear him, understand his problem, and with your knowledge as a lawyer at Tilakmar, you will take a decision. Is it a case for writ petition? Is it a case for an SLP? Is it an original jurisdiction suit? Or it is something else? Did he file a review before he came here in the High Court? Is the review still pending? Or the SLP stood rejected first and then can he go in a review? This all is your practice and procedure. One wrong decision on procedure will kill the fate of your client even on merits. So therefore please keep that, assess that, evaluate that importance of this subject. That aane wala when he has come, he has redo in your chamber at Tilakmar. You have to take the right route to come to these 15 courts. If you take a right decision that which route you have to take for approaching the bench for seeking that justice, your job as a professional is done. Otherwise everybody, we all of us know how much hearing is there in 136. 5 to 10 seconds you are out. But before that, it is extremely important that you took that right decision. For taking that right decision, that which remedy is going to be available to him, you must be required to equip yourself how many routes are available. Supposing I have to go to Rohini, I must know whether there is a metro station. Because if there is no metro station nearby, that's not a remedy, that's not a route available to me. Whether a three-wheeler goes there, whether there is a bus. So for deciding going to Rohini, you must know in how many manners you can reach Rohini. Same thing applies here. That if you have to approach Supreme Court, you must know how many routes you can adopt. Which one is the better route, where it is less expensive, where it is far more efficient, where it is far more effective and enduring. So you will be required to take that route, and for that you have to know how many routes are available. So the question then arises for the purpose of practice and procedure, how many routes in the nature of jurisdiction of distinct nature which are attached to the concept of Article 129 which creates the Supreme Court. Does it have any original jurisdiction? The first question is, what is an original jurisdiction? Generally, we know whenever you can file a civil suit, it's an original jurisdiction. If you go a little deeper, wherever you can begin the process of adjudication, that remedy is the original jurisdiction. Does the Supreme Court, being the apex court, has any original jurisdiction? Is there any area where some client falling in a particular category can initiate his original litigation from Supreme Court? For that, what are you supposed to read? Constitution as well as Supreme Court rules? You may start from 131. Is there any appellate jurisdiction with the Supreme Court? Is there any advisory jurisdiction with the Supreme Court? Is it a fact that there are certain inquiry proceedings also available within the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court? If a client which comes to you is a government, and the dispute is with another government, Section 9 CPC, you can always go to any civil court to start that litigation. Can you come to Supreme Court directly? If you know beforehand that there is some original jurisdiction in the Supreme Court, you are not going to go to the Sadari. You will say, for your enduring, faster, effective resolution of your dispute, is at Tilakmar, because they have original jurisdiction. Appellate jurisdiction is in contradistinction to original jurisdiction. Appeals may be matter of right, appeals may be discretionary. So whatever appeals which are available to the Supreme Court in its appellate jurisdiction, are they a matter of right or they are discretionary in nature? No. For that you may be required to read from 132 onward, 132, 33, 34, 134A, 136. You all are aware of it. I am not going to repeat it. Now, whereas there is an original jurisdiction for suits, there are certain original jurisdiction of the Supreme Court for writs. Should you file a writ petition directly in any given case for your client? Because if you go to these 15 courts, we have jurisdiction, go to High Court. Sometimes you may say, you may tell your client that, sorry sir, you have, the Supreme Court may say you go to the High Court and take your right first, but let us take a chance, we are not going to be worst off. This is one principle which you must accept from the first day, whether you become an advocate on record or not in this test. Are you going to be worst off? If it can work, and if it doesn't work, there is no harm, except some money and some fee. Why should it not be tested? This you will learn and realize only when you practice at Tilakmar. So that is another area where you know that there is a remedy available, but as some principle of law, self-restraint, you call it whatever name, the court is likely to say, no, go to Sher Shah Suri Mark. You are not worse off. Go to Sher Shah Mark and now the route would not be 32, it would be 136. So, one is 32, take a chance. Doesn't happen, go to Sher Shah Suri Mark and take 226. Doesn't work, come to 136. But in all this, there must be a genuine element of doing the best advice to your client. You may be the beneficiary in the bargain, but that should not be the first motive. The paramount consideration is the interest of the client. While serving that interest as an expert, who also, in addition to earning some money, is seriously wanting to build up his credibility and reputation, is keeping in mind the paramount interest of the client. Bring him here, take him there, but you are doing what is needed to be done for him. And for all that, it may be very important to know leading cases, but it would be far important to know practice and procedure. Not that I am saying you should attend my lectures and not others, but it's extremely important. Now for your benefit, I have prepared a small note and I handed over. So first thing, I like any person who has to say, sir, what are you supposed to do? You must know your course. Great tip. You must know all constitutional provisions. You must all know all the rules which are framed in the rules. You should also know handbook. You should know all these judgments. And no tips for your paper. Kindly abreast yourself with all the different remedies which are available under the Constitution, which you can invoke for getting some relief or succor to the client who approaches. This is the first thing which I wanted to tell you. Secondly, when you finalize the remedy which you are going to adopt, in addition to the facts of his case, please make a little effort to know the law of that subject before even you draft your petitions. It should become an integral, eminent part of your practicing as a professional that it is not that you look up the law after you have drafted the petition. Kindly have a look with the benefit of all SCCs and Indian.Kanoon.com and Manupatra and everything, it's hardly one click of the button. Please have a look at that beforehand so that, because that will make your decision making more easier and effective if you know the principles of law, also for your procedures. For that purpose, I've given with this note some suggested judgments which you may have a benefit, maybe not for your exam, but otherwise. For your question, practice and procedure. For the purposes of your paper now, the first suggestion, read your question paper very, very carefully. It is not something new. This I was told when I was in my first standard. Read your question paper very, very carefully. Now, here there is a necessity why I am saying so. Because some of the questions are going to be optional. Some of the questions are going to be mandatory. Some of the questions may have a large number of subparts where there may be some which are optional and some may be mandatory. So kindly spend some time, maybe 5, 7, 10 minutes, to read it very carefully that in your optional paper, which would you like to attempt and how many time you are going to apportion. Because most important thing in whatever little experience I have for the AOR exam is that we lose the habit of writing in last 5-6 years. Either we are typing on our own or we are using efficient, very cheap assistants, secretarial assistants. Yeah, that is another word to put it. I know that, but I would say secretarial assistant, which is very efficient and very cheap as compared. So it puts us off from the habit of writing with our own hand. Though it may be very relevant for our drafting examination, that about, I think, 17 years ago when I had written this exam, when I went out, approximately 90% of my colleagues who sat in that exam, they were not able to complete their exam writing. Most of them were only 1.5 questions. Because I'll tell you why, though you must have been told in the lecture for drafting. An SLP, starting with an index and list of dates, going to questions of law in the body of the SLP, accompanied by a certificate and affidavit, and then various applications for condonation of delay if required or exemption from filing a certified copy of the judgment, blah, 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 blah. If you start writing a 2-page affidavit, you'll need more than 40 minutes. And you have to prepare an SLP, and you will see that at the end of 3 hours, your SLP is not complete. And it is only 1 question out of 5. Even here, in the practice and procedure, that much of workload would not be there. But my earnest request to all of you, please start writing as much as possible in the few days which are coming now before your examination. Kindly keep writing. You will feel that your job is far easier. You are able to write more. You are able to complete your questions. More and more questions there, more subparts. Even in this paper, not that the content of the SLP will not give you good marks, but that getting good marks, the chance is little lesser, the proportion is going to little lesser as compared to not doing the question also. Supposing I put grade 5 grounds, but I am not able to complete the paper more than 3 questions, there is no point doing that. You must know how to prepare the structure. So please apportion the time for each question and strictly follow it. Otherwise you will end up that you have passed in all papers but you have failed in the drafting paper. Not because you didn't know, but because you were never left with any sufficient time to do it. So after seeing carefully which questions are optional and which questions are mandatory, please apportion a time which is practically the right time which is apportioned, and you adhere to that absolutely, so that by the time your clock is reaching the end of 3rd hour, your paper is complete. In addition to various jurisdictions which you must know, what are the essential conditions which must exist in the case of your client for invoking that jurisdiction you are also expected to know? Supposing you take the remedy of Article 32 for a particular case, the right which was involved was a fundamental right whose violation is alleged should be present. It should be so stated. Then the right writ prayer must also be there. Each provision of the Constitution, supported by the rules or along with the rules, for providing various remedies, also in those provisions lay down the conditions to be fulfilled to invoke those remedies. That is how 132 becomes different from 133. or 133 becomes different from 136, or 32 becomes different from all other, or statutory appeal which are under various statutory enactments. Every provision which gives you a remedy very, very clearly states the essential conditions in those provisions which you must know. And here, it must be kept in mind that for a Supreme Court advocate of record, he should not say, sir, I will read the provision and then decide. The essential conditions of those routes to approach the Supreme Court, you must remember. Nobody stops you from reference to the books and the provisions. But these essential 8, 10, 20 provisions, there is a very good word in Sanskrit, kanthast, yaad hona chahiye. You must clearly know how 136 is different from 132. Is 136 to begin with an appellate jurisdiction? I do not know. Is it purely a discretionary jurisdiction? I do not know. Are you supposed to be very, very honest to the court? I do not know. But this all is laid down. All the essential conditions are laid down in the provision themselves. Wherever there is any ambiguity or doubt or needed to be read, there has been given by the Supreme Court. So in relation to the provision which provide these remedies, I have appended a small list of judgments with that for your benefit, and I think it is being distributed. Kindly spare some time to have only a look at the head notes. And if you have time, please read the judgments. It may be helpful not for your paper, but when you come out of the paper, it would be needed by you on daily basis. Please know them. And therefore, to conclude and wishing you all the best, please complete your paper. Read it extremely carefully. Do not commit the mistake of doing 6 questions in a multiple question with subsection where only 5 are required to be done. Or don't attempt more questions from the optional chapter, leaving out the mandatory which was to be done. All the best. No questions. Thank you very much. There is one small note which is available.
Yes, sir.